Today, I'm going to discuss about authentication technique that is based on AES, or I can say that is based on block cipher. So what is the objective of learning the same? In the end, you will be learning new technique how to encrypt the data. And in the end, we will be obtaining data integrity and authentication on any of the data that is being transferred. So what is the origin behind the same? We are supposed to replace BES with any other algorithm, because you know, each and every algorithm has its own pros and cons. Same is the case with DES. DES too, like if somebody is expert in networking, and he has worked on the technology of DES, that is block cipher chaining, then it would be easy for him to detect the things, or I can say detect the underlying data that is being transmitted, because it is based on DES, and he know all the if and buts of the algorithm that are associated with the same. So in that manner, he will be able to extract the same. Which is the replacement? We can replace DES as well, because there could be some problems that are associated with DES, and we are supposed to overcome the same. How we are supposed to overcome the same? It could be any other version of the DES that could be there, or it could be any other algorithm that could be deployed. So what is basically the origin behind the same? So the origin behind the same is like, a clear replacement of DES when needed. And in addition, it is concerned with having theoretical attacks that can break it, and have demonstrated exhaustive key search attacks like brute force. Next, it can cause triple DES, but slow. It has small blocks. And US NIST issued calls for cipher in 1997. 15 candidates accepted in June 98. 5 were shortlisted in 1999. Arjun Dilge, who developed the RSA algorithm, it was selected as the AES in October 2000 and issued as FIPS PUB 197 standard in November 2001. So this was all about algorithm, like I can say the initials of the algorithm that I am going to discuss. So this is the main requirement that is associated with AES, because we are supposed to shift to the AES algorithm. What is basically AES algorithm? It is concerned with private key symmetric block. What is basically private key symmetric block? Symmetric block in which one key is used for encryption and one key is used for decryption. Like same key is used for encryption and decryption. But as compared to DES, you see, it is based on 128-bit data. That was based on 164-bit data. So in that, 128, 192, 256-bit keys will be used. But in that manner, we are supposed to use only 56-bit key. So that was the case here. In addition, it is stronger and faster than triple DES. It is stronger and faster than triple DES. Active life of 20 to 30 years. It could provide full specification and design details. It could be implemented in C and Java language. And NIST has released all the submissions and unclassified analysis. So what is basically, I can say, the requirements that actually are concerned with AES algorithm. So if we are talking about AES algorithm, then it is also known by its original name, Arjun Dilge. It is the author. So it is a specification for encryption of electronic data. Now, what is basically encryption? In cryptography, like encryption is the process of encoding information. So this process converts the original representation of the information known as plain text into an alternative form known as ciphertext. So ideally, only authorized parties can decipher a ciphertext back to the plain text. So that is what we are concerned with. We are basically dealing with encryption here. So it is converted into the ciphertext. So only authorized parties can decipher the ciphertext back into the plain text, and they can retrieve the original information. So encryption does not itself prevent interfaces, but it denies the intelligible content to a would-be interceptor. Next is for technical reasons. An encryption scheme usually uses a pseudo-random encryption key. Now, what is basically pseudo-random? Like pseudo, as a name implies, temporary names. It measures the extent to which a sequence of numbers, like it was produced by a completely deterministic and repeatable process, and it appears to be a pattern that could consist of like that could be appearing to be like patternless. So the pattern seeming randomless is the crux of much online and other security. Since the sequence is repeatable, it is important that the seed which together with the generator produce the number be well chosen and kept hidden. In addition, what is the history behind our algorithm that I am going to discuss? Like the generation of random numbers that has many uses, like in statistics for random sampling, simulation. And before modern computing, researchers requiring random numbers would either generate them through various means like dice, cards, routeless wheels, or use existing random number tables. So the first attempt to provide researchers with a ready supply of random digits was in 1927, when the Cambridge University Press published a table of 41,600 digits that were developed by this LHC Tippett. And in 1947, the R&D Corporation generated numbers by the electronic simulation of roulette wheel. So the results were eventually published in 1955 as a million random digits with 1 lakh normal deviates. So that is why it is concerned with pseudo-random function. So we can use a pseudo-random key, or I can say encryption key, that is generated by a algorithm. So what is basically algorithm? We are talking a lot about algorithm. What is basically the procedure behind algorithm? Like if we are dealing with mathematics and computer science, an algorithm is a finite sequence of well-defined computer implementable instructions that are typically used to solve a class of specific problems or to perform a computation. So they are always unambiguous. Unambiguous means they are not leading to create any confusion and are used as specification for performing calculations, data processing, automated reasoning, and other tasks. So in contrast, a heuristic, or I can say a based on guess, it is a technique that is used in problem solving that uses practical methods and or various estimates in order to produce solutions that may not be optimal but are sufficient given the circumstances. So as an effective method, an algorithm can be expressed within a finite amount of space and time and in a well-defined formal language for calculating a function. So starting from an initial state and an initial input, like it could be empty, the instructions describes a computation that when executed proceeds through a finite number of well-defined successive states. So eventually it could produce output and terminating at a final ending state. So the transition from one state to the next is not necessarily deterministic. Now, what is basically deterministic? It is the philosophical view that all events are determined completely by previously existing causes. Deterministic finite automation. What is deterministic finite automation? Output is already expected. This output will come after you are performing this process. So that output will be produced, and that is concerned with deterministic approach. So some algorithm that could be known as randomized algorithms, like it could be an algorithm that employs a degree of randomness as a part of its logic or procedure. So the algorithm typically uses uniformly random bits as an auxiliary input to guide its behavior in the hope of achieving good performance. It could incorporate random input. Next is the concept of algorithm has existed since antiquity, like arithmetic algorithms such as division algorithm that were used by greatest mathematicians and we are supposed to deal with the same. Like the word algorithm is derived from the name of the 9th century mathematician, and a partial formalization of the modern concept of algorithm began with attempts to solve the decision problems that are posed by various authors. So we are supposed to develop a flowchart that is associated with the same as well. Like, what is the informal definition? Like, it could be a set of rules or procedures that we are supposed to follow when we are dealing with a particular algorithm that precisely defines the sequence of operations, which would include all the computer programs, including programs that do not perform numeric calculations, and for example, like prescribed bureaucratic procedures or cookbook recipe. So in general, a program is only an algorithm if it stops eventually, even though infinite loops may sometimes prove desirable. But a prototypical example of an algorithm is Lucid algorithm that we have discussed so many times in our NSS class. Now, what is basically Lucid algorithm? So if we are talking about Lucid algorithm, it is concerned with the finding the factorization of the greatest number, or the GCD, greatest common divisor, of two integers. So Lucid algorithm is concerned with the same, and after doing the same, we are supposed to look at the GCD. Like if it is two, like if we are choosing two numbers, let's say this is 18 and one is 20. Let me show you the mathematical description. Just wait. Perform it on any number. Now, how we are supposed to find the same? We are considering 18 number. What would be the factors? 2 into 3 into 3. 3 the 9 to the 18, if we are talking about 24. What would be the factor? 2 into 12. Oh, sorry. 2, then into 2, just wait. Let me enlarge the same and telling you the mathematical concept behind GCD. It was 24, that is reduced to 12 by this way. After multiplication of 2, it is reducing to 12. After multiplication with 2, it is reducing to 6 the 12. After multiplication with 2, it is reducing 3. And 3. 2 to the 4 to the 8. 8 3 the into 3. That could be the case here. Okay, so this is the case of these factors. Now we are supposed to look at the GCD. We are supposed to look at the GCD. How we are supposed to compute the GCD of this one? What would be the GCD? Because we are supposed to compare these two factors. We are supposed to take the minimal factor for the same. So here it is 2 raised to power 1. So 2 raised to power 1 will be considered. And 2 raised to power 3 will be cancelled. Again, here it is 3 raised to power 1, and here it is 3 raised to power 2. So 3 raised to power 1 will be considered. So what is the factor for the same? It is the C. So GCD of these two numbers is 6. So in the same manner, we are supposed to calculate the Lucid theorem that is based on the GCD. So It is the efficient method for computing the GCD, that is greatest common divisor of two integers, that is the largest number that divides them both without a remainder. So it is named after the mathematician Lucid, who first described it in his Elements. It is an example of algorithm, that is a step-by-step procedure for performing a calculation according to well-defined rules. You can have a look at the rules that I have done in front of you. And it is one of the oldest algorithm in common use. So it can be used to reduce fractions to their simplest form and part of many other number theoretic and cryptographic calculations. In addition, the Lucid algorithm is based on the principle that the GCD of two numbers does not change if the larger number is replaced by its difference with a smaller number. For example, 21 is the GCD of 252 and 105. And the same number, 21, is also the GCD of 105 and 252. So replacement reduces the larger of two numbers. Repeating this process gives successfully smaller pairs of number until the two numbers become equal. So when that occurs, then they are the GCD of the original two numbers. They are the GCD of original two numbers. And by reversing the steps or using the extended Lucid algorithm, the GCD can be expressed as a linear combination of the two original numbers. That is the sum of two numbers, each multiplied by an integer. And the fact that the GCD can always be expressed in this way, and it is known as identity. So a prototypical example of algorithm we were discussing. So it is the Lucid algorithm that we have described right now. And it is used to determine the maximum common divisor of two integers. For example, let me show you the example of the same. If you remember, you might have dealt with flowcharts in your software engineering class in your fourth semester. What is flowchart? What is flowchart? It is the flow of the processes that is happening in a particular application or the software that you are going to develop. Same is the case here. If we are dealing with algorithm, then we can easily draw the flowchart for the same step by step. So it would be easy for us if there is a designing in front of us, like how we are supposed to produce, either we are moving to left or we are moving to right. So each and every step could be determined with the help of flowchart easily. So that is why we are supposed to use algorithm here. So we were talking about encryption all. So it is concerned with the electronic data that is established by the US NIST. You might have encountered this term NIST so many times. What is NIST? National Institute of Standards and Technology. It has set certain procedures and standards for what? Like that are concerned with the industry competitiveness. What is that? Like when we are dealing with any algorithm, what could be the standards that we are supposed to follow? So AES is the subset of block cipher. We have discussed a lot about block cipher. What is basically block cipher? Like in cryptography, if we are talking about block cipher, so what is block cipher basically? Like it is a deterministic algorithm. As I told you, what is basically deterministic algorithm? Like you will be given output and you are directed toward proceeding those steps that would be concluding that output that is given in front of you. So it will always produce the same output, operating on the fixed length or group of bits. These are called blocks. So it uses an unvarying transformation, that is, it uses symmetric key. So what is basically symmetric key? These are the algorithms for cryptography that use the same keys for both encryption of the plain text and decryption of the ciphertext. So the keys may be identical or there may be a simple transformation to go between the two keys, and the keys in practice share the shared secret. Now the these are specified elementary components. So what are basically those? These are well established low level cryptographic algorithms that are frequently used to build cryptographic protocols for computer security system. And these routines include, but are not limited to, one-way hash functions and encryption functions that could be used in the design of many cryptographic protocols. So what are security protocol? It is an abstract or concrete protocol that performs a security related function, and it could be applied to cryptographic methods. And often as sequence of cryptographic primitives, a protocol describes how the algorithm should be used and are widely used to implement the encryption of large amount of data, including data key exchange protocol. So even a secure block cipher is suitable for the encryption of only a single block of data at a time using a fixed key. So a multitude of modes of operation, like block cipher mode of operation, is an algorithm that uses a block cipher to provide information security such as confidentiality or authenticity. And a block cipher by itself is only suitable for the secure cryptographic transformation of one fixed length group of bits called block. So they have been designed to allow their repetitive use in a secure way to achieve the security goals of confidentiality and authenticity. So it is the act of proving an assertion, such as the identity of computer system user. In contrast with the identification, the act of indicating a person or the thing's identity. So it is the process of verifying that identity. It might involve validating personal identity documents. However, block cipher may also feature as building blocks in other cryptographic protocols, such as universal hash functions. So it refers to selecting a hash function at random from a family of hash functions with a certain mathematical property. So this guarantees a low number of collisions in expectation, even if the data is chosen by an adversary and pseudo random number generators are there. So what is basically the definition of, block cipher? Block cipher consists of two paired algorithms, one for encryption and other for decryption. Both algorithms accept two inputs, an input block of size n bit and a key of size k bit, and both yield an n bit output block. So the decryption algorithm D is defined to be the inverse function of encryption, and we are dealing with the function here. Just have a look at the same. Let me show you the same thing. So have a look at the scene. It's not visible. I think I am just enlarging the picture so that you could see the things that I am discussing here, because it is just for your knowledge so that you would be able to deduce what I am trying to say. So it is the problem of encryption by using certain key on the plain text P, that is E is associated with K and P, that is consist of 0, 1, that is raising to power K, that is key could be used into 0 and 1, that could be deriving 0 and 1 in the form of N. So which takes as input key K, that is having a length K called the key size, and a bit string P that would be a plain text of length N called the block size, and returns a string C of N bits. So P is called plain text and C is termed as ciphertext as we know. So for each K, the function E KP. Like after applying encryption on plain text with the help of TK, it is required to be an invertible mapping on 0, 1, that is raising to power n bits. So the inverse for E is defined as a function E inverse K on ciphertext C. We are dealing with here only ciphertext and key, that is decryption of DK with the ciphertext. So we will be directing toward DK, C, which is equal to 0, 1, that is raising to power K, into 0, 1, that is raising to power N, that is deriving 0 and 1 raised to power N. So taking a key and a ciphertext C to return a plain text P such that this could be our satisfying equation, that is K is deriving DK into EK over the plain text, which is equal to the plain text. So for example, a block cipher encryption algorithm might take 128-bit block of plain text as input and output a corresponding 128-bit block of ciphertext, but the exact transformation is controlled using the second input, that is the secret key. So decryption is similar, that is the decryption algorithm takes in this example a 128-bit block of ciphertext together with the secret key and yields the original 128-bit block of the plain text. So we are supposed to perform so many permutations here over the input block, and each key select one permutation from the set of 2 raised to power n factorial possible permutation. So what is basically permuted choice, or I can say what is basically permutation here? If we are dealing with permutation here, we are supposed to, if we are using a 128-bit key, then 8 bits might be lost during the process and it could be converted into 120 bits. In the same manner, if I am again performing permuted choice 2 and there are certain procedures, or I can say calculations, that are associated with my algorithm, then some bits might be lost during the course of the process. So next is, we are talking about AES, what is basically the same. Like it is the subset of block cipher. We have already discussed what is block cipher. It is developed by 2 Belgian cryptographers and who submitted a proposal to NIST during the AES selection process. Now the selection process is already discussed in this slide, if you remember. US NIST issued all call for ciphers in 1997. And 15 candidates accepted in June 98, but 5 were shortlisted in August 99. So Arjun Dale was selected as the AES in October 2000 and issued FIPS PUB 197 standard in November 2001. So this was about the how they developed the AES selection process. So it supersedes the DES, like which was published in 1977, and the algorithm described by AES is symmetric key encryption. So meaning that the same key is used for encryption and decryption. Now we are supposed to define the decryption of the, or I can say description of the ciphers. So what is the description technique that is behind the same? So it is based on the design principle known as substitution permutation network. So what is basically substitution? We have talked a lot about substitution permutation. So what is basically substitution permutation? Like in cryptography, an SP network, or I can say substitution permutation network, it is the series of linked mathematical operations that are used in block cipher algorithm, such as AES or any algorithm that you can add to the same. So such a network takes a block of plain text and key as input and applies several alternating rounds or layers of substitution boxes. Now what is the function of substitution box? Like I am having 64-bit input And after this, there are certain operations that could be applied to 64-bit input. After applying that operation, there it could be the case that my some bits are lost. So there could be 60 bits in as a result. Now, what is substitution here? I am supposed to substitute those 4 bits anyhow. Then I am supposed to insert those 4 bits so that the pattern could not be violated, or I can say integrity could not be lost. So in that manner, I am supposed to substitute various bits according to the pattern that is defined for particular algorithm that we are going to use. So after filling those, or I can say after substituting those bits with the help of the gap will be filled and those 4 bits will be substituted, and then only other operations on the same input cipher input text will be proceed. Otherwise it would stop proceeding further. Why? Because some bits are lost and the machine could not recognize if it is not up to the mark or if it is not containing 64 bits. So this is the process, like this is the layman process. I can say I have defined the process in layman terms. Let's discuss about what is basically substitution. We are supposed to use various substitution boxes, permutation boxes like S box and P box to produce the ciphertext. And we are given with already fixed patterns that we are supposed to arrange that bits in that fashion, we are supposed to substitute in that manner, and we are supposed to permute in that manner. So that is not our business, that is already defined to us. Our only function is to perform the functions in an effective manner. So it is S-box and P-box transform sub-blocks of input bits into output bits, and it is the common for these transformations to be operations that are efficient to perform in hardware such as exclusive or bitwise rotation. So the key is introduced in each round, usually in the form of round keys that is derived from it. So S-boxes themselves depend on the key in some cases. And decryption is simply done by the reversing the process by using the inverses of S boxes and P boxes and applying the round keys in reverse order. So what is basically component behind the same? You can have a look at the S box and P box. Just wait, I can show you. Have a look at the same. So this is what I am talking about. Any plain text could be there, and parallelly we are supposed to use the key as well, and that could be XORed here. Plain text and key zero are getting XORed, and they are fed to the substitution boxes in the form of the blocks. Let's say it is consist of 4, 4, 8, 16 bit plain text is there. With the help of the key, we are XORing the same. And after that, we are receiving 4-bit block here, 4-bit block here, 4-bit block here, 4-bit block here. And these 4-bit blocks are producing the output of 4-bit. It is also producing the output of 4-bit. It is also producing the output of 4-bit. It is also producing the output of 4-bit. So that could be permutated. Mean to say we are supposed to shuffle each and everything here. And the last, after performing permutation here, we are receiving 4-bit from this block, 4-bit from this block, 4-bit from this block, and 4-bit from this block. So these 4-bit blocks, like 4, 4, 8, 8, 8, 16. Then again, these 16 bits are XORed with the second key. Again, the same procedure is there. 4-bit, 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 4-bit. Substitution box number 1, 2, 3, and 4. That would be mixing here. Again, after mixing, or I can say permutation, we are receiving. 4-bit, there are no bit that are getting lost here. 4-bit, 4-bit, 4-bit is the output. That is again XORed with the second number key, and this process continue. It depends on number of rounds that we are going to undertake, or that a particular algorithm going to undertake for a particular algorithm. So in that manner, we are supposed to deal with substitution boxes and permutation boxes, because there is a diagrammatic description for the board. So what is basically component here? If I am talking about S box, like it substitutes the small block of bits, that is the input of the S box, by another block of bits, the output of the S box. This substitution should be 1-to-1. This substitution should be 1-to-1 to ensure invertibility, hence description. So in particular, the length of the output should be the same as the length of the input. As I have shown you in the picture, the right S box with 4 input and 4 output bits are there, which is different from S boxes in general. That could also change in length, as in DES, because in DES, an S box is usually not a simple permutation of the bits. Rather, a good S box will have the property that changing the one input bit will change about half of the output bits. Because that is concerned with avalanche effect. Now, what is basically avalanche effect? If I am changing any one input, it could make drastic changes in the output. Minor changes in any one of the input could lead to drastic changes in the output. So that is what avalanche effect is. So it is also having the property that each output bit will depend on every input bit. And on the other hand, if I am talking about P box, it is the permutation of all the bits. It takes the output of all the S boxes of one round, permutes the bits, feed them into the S boxes of the next round, and a good P box has the property that the output bit of any S box are distributed to as many S box inputs are possible. So at each round, the round key obtained from the key with some simple operations, for instance, like using S box and P box, it is combined using some group operation, typically XOR. So there are certain properties that are associated with the same, like a single typical S box or a single P box, it does not have much cryptographic strength. And S box could be thought of as a substitution cipher, while a P box could be thought of as a transposition cipher. So what is basically transposition cipher? Let me tell you the same. In cryptography, if I am talking about transposition, we are supposed to change the position. Transposition, we are supposed to change the position of the bits. It is the method of encryption by which positions held by units of plain text, like characters or a group of characters, they could be shifted according to the regular system, so that cipher text continues a permutation of the plain text. So that is, the order of the units is changed and the plain text is reordered. For example, I can show you an example. I am showing you an example, just wait. Now have a look. I think it is quite visible now. I am enlarging the picture so that you can easily understand what I am trying to say. Now we are taking the example of rail fence transposition cipher. We are discovered flee at once. So this is my plain text, that is, we are discovered, flee at once. We are discovered, flee at once. So this is the simple plain text that we are going to arrange in such a manner that we are supposed to change the pattern of the bits, and it could be understood in some other form. So we are arranging in the form of rows and columns. This one is the first row, first character. Second row, second character. Third row, third character. We are, then diagonally we are representing the same. We are, then again second row, second row, fourth column. Then fifth column and first row are discovered, D-I-S-C. So in that manner, we are supposed to arrange the bits, and we will be reading it as W-E-C-R-L-T-E, okay? E-R-D, W-E-C-R-L. We are converting it into the block of five letters. W-E-C-R-L. T-E-E-R-D, that is written here, S-O-E-E-F, yes, E-A-O-C-A, E-A-O-C-A, I-V-D-E-N. So in that manner, we are supposed to arrange the simple text. Now, who can say that it is we are discovered and flee at once, that is written here? Nobody could know. And what is the procedure behind the same? If I am not relating to, I am not expert in networking, or I do not know the if and buts of networking, then how could I determine? It is not visible to me. What is written here? W-E-C-R-L, what is this? So this could be the case. So this is basically technique that we are supposed to use in transposition cipher. This is basically rail fence technique. So well-designed SP network with several alternating rounds of S and P box already satisfies Shannon theories of confusion and diffusion. Now, what is Shannon theory of confusion and diffusion? Because now we are dealing with cryptography and we are in the last unit of cryptography. So everything we have studied earlier, that is connected here in fifth unit. So Shannon theory of confusion and diffusion, we have already discussed. This is also based on block cipher algorithm, basically DES. So the reason for diffusion is the, like if one changes one bit of the plain text, then it is fed into the X box whose output will change at several bits. Then all these changes are distributed by the P box among several S boxes. Hence the output of all of the S boxes are again changed at several bits. And so on. So doing several rounds, each bit changes several times back and forth. So therefore, by the end, the ciphertext has changed completely. So in a pseudo-random manner, as I explained you earlier, in particularly for a random chosen input block, if one flips the ith bit, then the probability that the jth output will change is approximately a half for any I and j, which is strict avalanche creation. So vice versa, if one changes one bit of the ciphertext, then attempts to decrypt it, the result is a message completely different from the original plain text. So SP ciphers are not easily malleable. So the reason for confusion is exactly the same as for diffusion. Like changing one bit of the key changes several of the round keys, and every change in every round key diffuses over all the bits. So changing the ciphertext in a very complex manner. Even if an attacker somehow obtains one plain text corresponding to one ciphertext, a known plain text attack, a chosen plain text or a chosen ciphertext attack, the confusion and diffusion makes it difficult for the attacker to recover the key. So this was about AES and or I can say the description of the cipher that I have discussed. In addition, so much is left about AES that we will be discussing in the next class. So you can have a look how we can arrange 16 bits. Just wait, I can show it to you, and then I am winding the lecture up. now have a look at the same. Just I am enlarging the picture so that it could be easily visible to you. So this is the way how we are supposed to arrange the 16 blocks. B0, B1, B2, B3, B4, B5, B6, 16 blocks are there now. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, and 15. Today's lecture. If you are having any queries, you can ask me any question. In addition, reference book is given so that you can have a look at the reference book. It is a book by William Stalling that is available in the college library. You can get it issued from the library and have a look at the same, and reference questions are given here. You can do the same. Ten questions are given for the reference. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So 10 questions are given. Just take the snapshots for the same and in the end of the lecture, you are supposed to submit me the same. So this was all about my today's class. Thank you. Have a nice day.